A lot of non-ham stuff in that episode.
But they'll like it.
Okay.
All right, we are back. Ham Radio Now, episode 32, part 2, Stuff, California, TWiT, Leo, and Stuff. And I think we are at the Leo and TWiT part.
I'm anxious to see how this stuff differs from the stuff in part 1.
You're looking for a little more ham radio. About the only thing ham radio about part 1 was the Stanford station.
Well, and the ham tour guide at the Coke Museum.
It wasn't a ham.
Well, you didn't. Did you ask?
No. No. I think the bear might have been a ham.
Okay.
Look around Petaluma a little bit. Petaluma is a very quaint, pretty little small town that's got the TWiT studios in it. They got a main street. They got a river. And Leo refers to all these things. It's a big antiquing place, big restaurant place, but it's still a very small town. Mm-hmm. And then the TWiT studios themselves in the what they call the TWiT Brickhouse, which I think they were originally going to call the Brick TWiT House. And then somebody, and it might have been Leo, put his foot down and said, no, we're not going to call it that. We're going to call it the TWiT Brickhouse, which they only been in for a little over a year now. And had been in just about a year when we shot this stuff. We were there on a Saturday. And Leo does the Tech Guy radio show from the studios on Saturday and Sunday. Mm-hmm. So when we got there, he was doing the show, and their head of their studio, John Slanina, and that's probably not his official title, also known as JammerB, gave us a tour while we were waiting to be able to talk to Leo. We talked to Leo at the beginning of this tour, mm-hmm. and then a little bit later on. So we're going to head on in and do this tour.
Oh,
this
will be good.
Yeah, and this is stuff I have not edited yet as Jeff and I sit here talking, so we're not going to be able to comment on it.
I haven't seen the footage either. I look forward to seeing the edited version first.
Yeah, so we'll come back at the end of all of this, and this is where it's going to get awkward, and I'll do some voiceover and stuff and clean things up. But
all this techno babble.
Off we go. Voice that's what this. That's what that editing is all about. That I don't like to do and am going to do for you, just for you, the Ham Radio Now audience.
We're glad you do.
This time, and I'll do I got a few more, and we'll do it from time to time. You know how much editing I do depends on?
How fat Arvin gets.
How big, perfect. Well. I like that. All right, let's go see Jammer B and Leo.
Let's do it.
Tell you what, let's start up on the roof. But we noticed that there are no HF antennas permanently mounted on top of the TWiT studios. Everything you've seen in previous episodes of Ham Nation have been temporary. There's just this one lonely VHF-UHF vertical. Let's go inside.
Shall we visit the basement?
Let's visit the basement. So we have
Wait, sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry. I know you're... No, I'm not.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So we have a special guest on Ham Radio Now, someone who knows what's going on here. Right now, he's busy.
There you go. Sorry about that, Leo.
the guy we came to see, Leo, is he's back here.
This is what's going on now. This can go on anytime.
You can edit that, huh?
We're gonna do a tour here.
Go ahead.
That's Leo.
Oh,
a radio show now.
Leo, you're on commercial break.
We have to be quiet. Mike, don't tell Bob Heil this.
Uh-oh. Don't take a shot of that microphone.
XLR, Mike. It's only $59, but it supposedly works with the iPad, digital. Don't tell Bob Heil. Are you using a Heil mic?
I'm afraid not.
Well, I guess we're all right then. I guess you won't be showing this to Bob.
I made a pitch for Bob to replace this with one of his.
I'm surprised he didn't.
And he didn't, so.
Well, so there you go. What kind of mic is that?
It's a standard Electrovoice RE50.
Bob hates EV.
He does. Yeah, I was down at the HRO in Atlanta with Gordon.
Ham Radio LA.
Yeah, and I unplugged
my transmitter from this mic and I plugged in his, and I went, and this is what Bob's, whoa, Bob.
It sounds a lot better, doesn't it, Bob?
Oh, I'm in the shot.
Wait a minute, don't you want him in the shot?
Not that part of me. No, it wasn't my head that was in the shot.
I believe you do, Dr. Mama, so we're going to see. We're going to test this because they claim iPad.
So we'll be right back.
I ordered an Apogee mic, which is 100%.
We're going to go downstairs. We're going to go see about what makes this stuff run.
About 20 seconds till he has to end this commercial break and go back on the air.
So he'll be back on the air in a second. I feel like a golf announcer. In just a few seconds, Leo will be back on the air.
Since I'm giving a tour, let's start up here.
Okay. Oh, okay. We're going to start up here.
All right. So,
tell people who you are.
My name's John Slanina. I'm the studio manager for TWiT, which means I have a bunch of engineers that I boss around and make them do all the hard work while I get to do stuff like procurement. Anyway, this is the TWiT Brickhouse, which we built from January to July of last year. July 24th was our opening day, so we're not quite a year old yet. And it's hard to imagine what it was like before we moved in, because I can remember specifically thinking, oh my God, I can't imagine what it's going to be like to work here. And now I work here every day, and it's hard to imagine what that feeling was. And it's also hard for me to imagine what it's like for someone like you, who until today had only seen it through the camera.
Yeah, well, it is actually more compact, as you usually expect, mm-hmm. when you go see a TV studio. Things are smaller, a little bit smaller in person, because on TV things seem cavernous and enormous. You're watching on TV, it's going to look cavernous and enormous. But if you were standing here, you can see from one end to the other. Can't quite reach from one end to the other, but you can see. And it's, it's smaller than it seems. But
well,
it is not cavernous to me because
the cottage that we moved out of a couple blocks away was smaller than Leo's studio. We recreated the studio we had in the cottage here. This is actually a little bit bigger than the room this was in a block down the street, but it kind of does look like the cottage. We've added things like the monitor in the front of the desk and the lighting. We've improved the lighting, and there was mantles going behind Leo at the cottage, and the designer said, I don't want any lines going behind your head, so you can see that the mantles are only partial, and there's a big TWiT logo behind his head instead of the boards cutting off, shelf-like behind his head, as Tom Merritt has to deal with over here with the bookcase in the newsroom
set. So we don't care so much about Tom.
Yeah, we don't care about Tom.
Okay, so what do we got here?
So the cottage set, Leo's studio, which he does the Tech Guy, Windows Weekly, and Security Now, the room we were just in that's on the air right now, is set one. Then we have the newsroom set. Then we have Radio Corner back there. Then our big set, which is the round table set, shows like TWiT are done from.
See, now that table is an example of something that just seems a lot smaller, because on the air, it seems like it's about 40 feet wide. Well, 15 feet wide, but it's actually, it's your typical dining room table size.
And on the air, we generally don't let people see things like all the wires that are underneath that we are running around with.
The Dr. Evil chair.
Yes.
I'm going to set it in. Don't tell Leo.
Oh, don't let Leo see that.
I feel like a doctor, and I feel evil. This is Leo's Dr. Evil chair.
You have to get the camera right down here so you can get the real angle. You know, you got to get the logo. You got to tilt up and get the, yeah, there you go.
This is amazing.
And while you're doing that, what's your favorite color?
I guess we'll do purple, because that's the Ham Nation color.
Oh, yeah, purple's good. But, we have green and different colors. There's also... fire.
It's that stuff back there that's changing. It is all amazing.
So all of these sets have a single control point, and it's in a room upstairs back. No, it's not, actually. It's right over here.
Yeah, usually control rooms are behind some glass, and they're hiding way out of the way.
And you're looking at monitors.
Yep.
But with this, we can point our control desk at whatever studio is on the air. For example, if I want to watch myself do my business, I can point it at what we call the production alley. This is actually a set two. We do our LAN parties here. So I think we're up to like seven sets. But this, the control desk that has all the controls, can point all the way over to Radio Corner and then all the way back to the round table. Of course, we don't let it go 360 degrees because there's a lot of wires.
There's got to be some wires under there. And at what point do they turn into a knot?
In fact, there are no computers here. This looks like, oh my gosh, look at all the computers. There are no computers here. Well, the iPad is really a computer. So if you don't count the iPad.
And there's some debate about that, whether an iPad is a computer.
Well, it is certainly a type of computer.
My wife slash camera person is saying it's a computer.
So what we have is lighting control, video switcher for the TriCaster, and the audio board. Now, this is the monitor for the audio board. Those two monitors there are controlled by this. We have VidBlaster on that. It's another video switcher. We do our reruns from this machine. We pull up video on this machine. We do a lot of things on this machine. It's just a multi-purpose machine. Those are the two displays for the TriCaster. This is the one display for the Axia Element. This, which is on number four right now, actually has a KVM, so it has eight things on it, including the four Skype machines, our Mac that's recording our programs to the SAN right now, Wirecast, which is broadcasting to the stream, and some other machines that we just have for utility purposes. And all of those machines, everything here, because there are no computers here, we have a whole bunch of wires that go through a hole down into the basement.
And whose job is it to make sure you haven't gone around too many times?
It won't go 360.
Oh, okay.
It only goes 270.
You got to stop.
Okay. Yeah, it stops here and it stops there. I can't point it this way. So we will never be building a set here. All we will be doing here is playing video games at the TWiT Arcade, which is a donated MAME installation that has like 3,500 video games on it. It's just a Mac Mini that does emulation of old video games.
Four players.
Yes, it works well and it gets a lot of use. Okay, so now let's go see where these wires go.
Okay, let's give my wife a break because her arm is probably about to fall off. Okay, I have grabbed the camera because the lovely and talented Cindy's arm fell off.
And I think that we might have some monopods, but as I look, it occurs to me that the monopods might have gone to Vegas.
Yeah, the NAB anyway, is coming up this weekend as we record.
This little room is a place for two editors to work. It has fiber optic connections, which is a requirement for an editor's workstation. And Nicole Lee, our product manager, I don't know if that's the right word to call her, she's in charge of our product review show. So that is why she has many products on her desk. And this hallway is full of products and empty boxes that we have to return products.
These are all carefully tracked to make sure none
absolutely
wander away.
Clearly, the big 60-inch TV goes in that box. I can figure that one out. All right, so let's head down to the basement and we'll go past the kitchen. We have a kitchen. And what kitchen would not be complete without a disco ball? So.
Okay, so we're featuring the disco ball. There's a Tech TV sign.
Someday we will turn this into a set for the maker people who have Maker Faire. That's the goal. It's going to be very expensive to bring all the cabling over here and stuff, but it's an extra space that we have that is very convenient because it has a roll-up door and a loading dock, and when we loaded all the equipment to take to NAB, we have it all in the basement. We put it on the conveyor belt and brought it up the conveyor belt. We have a conveyor belt.
Oh, my.
Yeah, so some of the things, some poles and things are too awkward and misshapen to put on the conveyor belt, but everything in boxes and anvil cases, a lot easier than carrying it up.
Yep. Hams are real interested in getting those maker folks to get ham licenses because we think there's a natural fit there.
I agree. So let me light this up. This is the way to the basement, one of the ways to the basement. There's another entrance on the other side.
So you were saying there were no computers upstairs except for the iPad.
Well, at the control surface, at the control turret,
yeah,
the control desk, the thing that spins around with all the control surfaces. So here's our basement, and it is quite spacious, and we are very lucky to have all of this. The ceiling is too low for anyone to work here, but it's a perfect place to store stuff. And of course, before we went to NAB, we mocked up the stage. The blue tape there was where we mocked up our NAB stage. We had the TriCaster, we had the microphones, we had the cameras, we had everything working in this space before we packed it up all in the truck, put all the heavy things on this cart, rolled the cart over to the conveyor belt, and loaded it up to the loading dock.
There's the conveyor belt. So, I mean, these things we never see on TWiT.
No. Well, there have been some, they do some funny bits on our show Ion, which is not really a show in other news. The very first broadcast from TWiT, some people have, from the TWiT Brickhouse, some people have made claims that they were the first one. One time, Justin Robert Young snuck in here and did a remote through Skype to the cottage during Tech News Today, and he claims he was the first one to broadcast from TWiT. Truth be told, that night back in March when we got our internet connection and I came here and I set up our router, a simple router and a Wi-Fi access point so we could have Wi-Fi up there, after our show had just ended at the cottage, I called in on Skype with my computer with the freshly minted network here, was showing people around the different areas, and it looked quite different than it does now. I would point everyone to the time lapse of us building it, which I'm quite proud of. And I showed people the conveyor belt. I put my computer on the conveyor belt and set my computer down a couple feet. And then I was talked into sitting on the conveyor belt with the computer. And everyone got to see me ride the conveyor belt down, the very first broadcast from the TWiT Brickhouse. I'm staking claim. All right.
And who could possibly deny it?
It can't be denied because it was the night that I set up the network.
Okay, so you got some hardware down here?
Well, this is where we store stuff, and the hardware is here. Let's go this way first. In addition to all the audio-visual equipment, you need your IT infrastructure. This would traditionally be a server room, but we really don't have any servers. So what it is it's where we have our gateways and our routers and our switches and our SAN. Very important, the SAN is down there. The SAN is what is being, all the shows are recorded to the SAN. All the editors have fiber optic connections to the SAN, so they copy the file that's recorded. We don't have to copy files around. The SAN performs very well. They can record right on the SAN. I'm very thrilled by the color scheme that's set up here. We have the yellow ones for production, and those are like Leo's computers in his office and people who are on the air with their laptops. This has real good down. The down is prioritized. We don't really care so much about the up. But if they want to pull up a web page while they're on the air, we want it to come up really fast. The E is for the editors, this orange one. And this is the one that has a real high up speed because the editors have to throw their product into the cloud. So this has an up prioritized. This also has up prioritized, this red one. This is the streaming network. It's segregated. And our streams to our video partners and our audio are on this red one. The blue one is the lowest priority. This is the one I get to tie into. This is the office network. It works just fine. When we moved in here, we were getting promised 35-35 symmetrical from SonicNet, Ethernet to the first mile. Unfortunately, that uses the telephone wires, and the telephone wires are 50 years old or so or more and in very bad shape. And AT&T, who was responsible for the telephone wires, would come and say, yeah, you got a connection. It was a very bad connection, but they didn't care, and we couldn't get that infrastructure rebuilt. What we ended up doing was talking to Comcast. They couldn't get Comcast in here because of some building access. Anyway.
No, we're not in Silicon Valley. We're in Petaluma, California.
Yeah.
I mean, we're
Hour north of San Francisco.
Yeah, I mean, this is a small town.
Relatively small town, yep.
And it's not a high-tech town.
It's bucolic paradise.
Yeah. So how do you get bandwidth here at all?
It's not a really small town. We do have Comcast. I mean, there is bandwidth available in the town. Sonic has their head in here, and we could get good bandwidth from Sonic if we had good wires. What we ended up doing was making a deal with Comcast, and they dug up the street. Well, they used one of those ditch witch things that makes a big hole several times all the way back to almost to where the cottage is, about a block and a half down the street, tied in and brought us fiber. And the fiber has 100 symmetrical up and down. And while they were doing it, they brought us cable. And you can see back here, this is the box that the fiber comes in on, and this is where the copper is. So now we have, and the copper, I think, is like 50/10. So in addition to the Sonic 3535, which is flaky, we now have the 100/100 copper and the 50/10, or the 100/100 fiber and the 50/10 copper. And all of that stuff is segregated using gateways so that some things are prior, like the streaming is the most solid and has the most redundancy. Upstream, the editors upstream is really fat. The production downstream, so the computers online or on the air can pull up their web pages really fast. Presumably, we've done all this stuff right. We've still been fine-tuning it for a while, and we'll continue to fine-tune it. We had to change out our access points. We had great bandwidth, but the Wi-Fi wasn't, because there is a lot of noise around here, as you discovered, and there's a lot of different Wi-Fis competing with each other. So we got rid of the $600 or $700 Cisco access points that we had, and we got a $3,000 HP access point, an enterprise level access point that has made a big difference for the Wi-Fi access, especially the iOS devices. The iPad on the control desk controls something in the other room. It kept dropping out. It kept losing its connection, and it'd be freaking out because we need to change stuff on it. And it turns out that it was the Wi-Fi thing with the HP or the Cisco router. It has been solid since we have the HP enterprise level router. So it's just a matter of so much interference in this area to get a solid connection. So I like to call this the brains of the operation. Leo would be the soul of the operation. So this room here, the gateways, the SAN, the NAS storage that we have, all of this would be the brains of the operation. And you can see that it's color-coded and very nicely done. And I will point out over here that there are no green cables.
And why no green cables?
I just like to say that.
No good reason.
No, well, there's a good reason, but I'm not going to tell you yet. So we're leaving the brains of the operation. Following what I like to call the aorta. To our AV room. Now, when we built this, and you'll see on the time lapse, there's no building here, no walls. It's just another part of the basement. Because the basement was very cool. And we figured, oh, this is nice and cool.
But time lapse is still available to watch online.
Yes,
right?
If you go to insidetwit.tv, it's about it's maybe 10 posts down. If you go through, if you go to YouTube, you can find it. We can put up a link. So anyway, I don't know. It's like insidetwit.tv, like brickhouse-timelapse-video or something like that. But we'll put up the link.
Yeah, I'm actually probably showing it now, as we speak, since I get to edit this.
It was cold in the basement, so we decided we didn't need to air condition the equipment. We put the equipment in. It got hot in the basement. So we built a room around the, and in the time lapse, you can see Russell, our IT guy, says, you're really going to need to air condition this. And you can see the blue tape he puts out. This is where the room's going to be. The room came several months later. And unfortunately, I came in at 10 o'clock one day, and I walked down here, and the room was half built. And I didn't even know they were going to build it, or I would have gotten that on the time lapse too. Anyway, brains, aorta, heart. Audio video room, directly below the control turret. there's the hole with all the wires that go up to the control turret.
Hi, Alex. I think I see him.
So, my audio rack. This has all the Axia gear, the digital audio system that just is so cool that allows us so much flexibility.
And a hat tip to Kirk Harnack.
Absolutely. This stuff is, I mean, we have the microphones with XLR cables that are converted to Cat 6. And the Cat 6 is this Cat 6 that you see that's part of the infrastructure. And it goes into a patch bay I have back there. And it goes to some line in nodes, some analog nodes, they call them, and then microphone nodes, and then the brains of the system, the power station. Down at the bottom are the audio processing units, the Omnia 1X and the Omnia 8. Those are the things that come at the very end of the signal that make our audio sound extra sweet. We have Leo's voice starting extra sweet, sweetened by Heil's microphones, and then Kirk's audio processing gear to make it the best sounding podcast you'll hear on the internet.
Yeah, if Leo were older than me, and he's not, I would see if I could get him to will me his voice.
Boy, isn't he lucky to have, and things to say.
Yeah.
Not only does he have the voice, he's got things to say.
And he knows how to use it. I mean, it's a gift, but he has parlayed it.
Video. This is the video. We were only going to have two racks, then we figured, you know, we're going to need some more equipment. So this is the video rack. This is the thing that the iPad controls. Video. It's a 72N 144 matrix switcher. I can put any camera, any computer screen, any video input I have, I've used actually 68 of the 72 inputs, into any of 144 outputs. The TriCaster itself only has 8 inputs. So the first 8, the primary 8 that we switch with this are to the TriCaster. But we have monitors all over the place. We have the VidBlaster that lets us do TriCaster-like things that we can put any sources into. The flexibility that this video hub allows us, it's just something that I couldn't even imagine 5 years ago. And it's just so exciting. But then again, there's the TriCaster. I'm sorry there's nothing on these screens. I was doing some testing before NAB, and you know, I have this cable here so I can test stuff and it'll show up on this screen. And I was testing the live view endpoints, which are over here, and I haven't routed. I have in this view, I have the program going, but the TriCaster is another integral part of our operation, the video switcher. We won't talk about Video, we need to take this equipment away and send it back to them or something. That was a failed experiment. Here, we have a bunch of cool racked machines. Skype, each Skype is on an individual machine. So here's our 4 Skype rack-mounted PCs. When they were new, or we had new ones and they weren't hooked up, it was real cool to open them up, pull them out, and show you how neat these modular rack-mounted server units are. These we got for like $600 each. They were last year's machines. They've got 2 3.5-inch hard drives right here in the front. The 4 Skype machines we use all the time for our remote hosts. In fact, our network is kind of built on Skype. We're looking for some Skype alternatives, and we got some things in the pipeline, but it's amazing what Skype has done for us.
It's been sort of mixed. It is not totally reliable.
Better than anything else.
Yeah.
And for the price?
Which is free.
Yeah. So free these are last year's machines. Now this machine, I talked about the VidBlaster machine. It's a pretty heavy duty machine. These are this year's machines. And this year's machines cost about $6,000 because nobody wants to buy last year's machines. And if I figure out how to open it up, I can show you that instead of 2 3.5-inch drives, it's got 6 2.5-inch hard drives. Oh, this stuff is very cool. You can see we only have 1 hard drive actually being used right now, but I just love these machines. And if they weren't hooked up in the back and running, I would show them to you and show you all the fun things inside of them.
I think you're working in the right place. You are clearly in toyland.
I've died and gone to heaven. Actually, I've retired and gone to heaven. This is what I'm getting to do in my retirement, and they pay me, and they provide my Diet Coke. Oh, my gosh. All right, so this is the VidBlaster machine. We do a lot of things with upstairs, those 2 screens at the control desk. This is the one running Wirecast. This is the streaming machine. This is streaming the video to our partners, Big Gravity, Justin, and Ustream. So this is a very important machine. This is what's putting us on the air. We got a second streaming machine. This is a second streaming machine that we temporarily use for our local encoding. We bought a new server that does the encoding for us. We had to move from MediaFly to encoding locally at the end of January. It was a big deal. We were using that temporarily, but now this, a second streaming machine, is streaming the HTML5 live stream to things, applications like the Roku box and iOS applications. So this machine is also streaming, and right now it has the BitTorrent server on. We've been experimenting with BitTorrent Live. We really need to segregate the BitTorrent Live away from this machine because the BitTorrent Live is not very reliable. We have it set up so if it crashes, it restarts, but every time it crashes, the people watching live on the Roku box have to wait for it to restart. So we need to segregate the BitTorrent client away from it. But we want to have the ability to have our feeds available to as many people as many places as possible. So BitGravity, Justin, Ustream, HTML5 live streaming, and BitTorrent, and maybe some other things in the future. And we certainly thank our partners for the bandwidth, especially CashFly. Oh my gosh. Most of the bandwidth we use is from the downloads, not the live stream. And that bandwidth is provided from CashFly, and it is a very large number. Thank you, CashFly. Oh, this is a nice rack. The other cool thing is nobody can figure out how to open it. It's got like a Chinese puzzle here you could not open this. I know the trick. And it's not locked, so it's easy. So lastly, we got some additional switches up here. So, oh my gosh, what color is this? Oh no.
I was gonna say, see some green wire here.
Oh dear. So these two computers are our live view endpoints. They will be getting the feed from the stage at NAB, and when we take a live view unit into the field, these will be these are hooked into the video hub, right? So these are another set of inputs that I could put anywhere. Well, I would put them into the TriCaster and switch them to the stream. Down here is a machine that we're experimenting with different ways to play reruns overnight so they're on a schedule. That's not quite in production yet. This is the recording Mac Pro that has fiber, the fiber connection. All the Mac Pros running Final Cut are connected by fiber to the SAN. So this is recording to the SAN. The editor's workstations have fiber. They're going to edit straight off the SAN. Saves a lot of time in editing. You don't have to copy the files, and the SAN is very responsive. An issue we have is we got a lot of material on the SAN. We need to improve our NAS storage. We're going to get another server that will be able to regularly put stuff on, get it off the sand, freeing up space on the sand so that a show doesn't stop recording in the middle because the sand filled up, which has happened. Anyway, you saw how neat and orderly all the wires were at the other end in the server room.
I wanted to say I was very impressed.
I didn't do any of that. We hired people to do that. All of these wires, you know, we had an infrastructure company. Obviously, there was no wall here when they put in the wires. The wall had to be built around the wires and the fire extinguishers. But there are wires that we did do ourselves. And if you are brave of heart and strong of stomach, come on back here and see the wires that I did. Green is my audio network. This is the stuff that isn't Ethernet. It's analog audio straight up to the microphones on the different sets. And it goes into my microphone nodes with these adapters that convert RJ45 into XLR. And that, so the microphones come in here. Now you notice some pink ones. We have line level unbalanced inputs from like an iPhone or an iPad, just little jacks they can plug in, and those show up on the Axio board, and those go into the line level nodes, but they have to be powered. So the thing comes out of the line level nodes, goes down into these power injectors, and then the pink ones indicate that they have power in them. And then so the, all of these go up to little matching amplifiers that convert the unbalanced signal to a balanced signal, because to go over the Cat 6 cable, it's got to be balanced. The unbalanced wouldn't carry over the distance that we need without getting a lot of interference. So this is the back of my audio cable. And oh my gosh, you can't really see it, but the back of the video hub. You really can't get in there with your fingers and get to twist those B and C connectors.
You have one of those tools?
So we have tools. Yeah. So you have the special tool. You just hook it on a cable and say, okay, go to the end of that cable, disconnect that connector.
Yeah, let me see, let me get a look at the tool here. And the only problem is that, sometimes you can't really see where things came from.
Which is why we're very careful with our labeling. I don't. Most of these cables you will see have really nice permanently attached labels on them. So labeling is very important. And then here's the back of those rack computers, the Skype machines, the VidBlaster machine, the two streaming machines. Oh, look, they've got names on them. Makes it easier. And then Axiom Management is just a spare machine that helps allows me to get to the graphical user interface of all these devices from any other machine on the network. It also keeps time. It's the machine that is our NTP server for all the computers that are using an NTP server.
So it may be not quite as neat as the other racks, but I've seen worse because I've built worse.
It works, you know, and that we were building this, right? And I have every intention of coming back and making it neat, but every day we're working and fixing things that go wrong and moving from set to set and doing all the stuff we need to do. But at some point, I will make this look very nice. I promise. And you can come back and take a picture then, too.
We'll be back.
So normally you would have to traditionally work at a big television station or a network to and be really lucky to get a job to get to work with this high-powered equipment like this. And I guess I've gotten lucky, and we're making a new kind of television station. But I love this stuff.
This is the new television. This is where television is going. Leo's convinced of it. I think you are. I am. So, John, thank you very much.
My pleasure, Gary.
We're going to go back upstairs and see Leo. And Leo, he likes his
job. I hope he hasn't called for me while I've been down here.
He seems self-sustaining.
Yeah, he had plenty of coffee this morning, so he's good. Although it is about time to ask him what he's going to want for lunch.
Let's go see the tech guy.
Well, a good day to you, Leo Laporte here, the tech guy.
So this is Leo, of course, in his element, doing the tech guy show. The shot we're looking at now is from near one of the cameras that's in his studio that you see once in a while when he's doing the program, if you watch online. But we can look around and see some of the things you don't get to see. First, there is room for a small audience, three or four chairs. So you can come and watch the Tech Guy show live on Saturday and Sunday. But there's not much room, so you want to sign up as well in advance as you can. There's instructions on their website for how to do that. It's not a formal procedure. You're basically sending email. And if they've got room, they'll let you in. There's plenty of room in the rest of the building for people to wander around, and they're not very strict about that, apparently. But you do want to make sure you're signed up in advance.
You know, it's a good designer, good programmers.
Leo is surrounded by cameras, and he does all of his own technical production. He switches the cameras, does his own audio, except for what Kyle does back at the main studio in L.A. He's surrounded by these monitors, the audio mixer. He can see the chat room.
Yeah, but the truth is, I think you hit the nail on the head, Jerry. The growth is forced because if you want to play in the Google space, which everybody needs to.
And it's pretty much a self-contained production.
You kind of have to join Google Plus.
Leo is as accommodating as he can be for interviews, for, you know, little podcasters like me. The day we showed up, though, they were getting ready to go to the NAB for the week, and they had to shoot an extra program Saturday afternoon. So we just had a little time to squeeze in an interview between the end of the Tech Guy show and the Giz Whiz, and then they had to go shoot an advanced episode of iPad Today. So this is our short interview with Leo Laporte, W6TWT, the Tech Guy.
hi. It's a little weird. I got two mics. I guess I don't need that.
Don't need that.
There we go.
So, I mean, what I really like to do is a Leo Laporte brain dump.
Okay.
Because, you know.
That might take a while.
That might take a while. And what I realized was that that's really just watching TWiT all day, every day.
Yeah, that's pretty much what TWiT is. It's a Leo Laporte brain dump.
So let's stick to ham radio. Are we rolling over there? Okay, we're rolling. When did you first hear about ham radio?
Well, I've known about ham radio for a long time. In fact, one of my good friends in college, the guy who ran the local radio station with me, was Eric Schwartz. We went to school together. And, yeah, of course, now he's in charge of Elecraft. Yeah. He runs Elecraft.
And we've talked to him on ham radio.
He's great.
Now.
And he's a great guy. So, you know, if you're a geek, which I think I am, it's hard not to run into hams all the time. I never got around to it. And I think probably the main reason I didn't do it is because of the code requirement, to be honest. I'm not alone in that, I think.
Not at all. And it's a divide in ham radio. Yeah. You know, it's a very fractionalizing, but where people, I think, are getting over it.
Well, I want to learn CW. I really do. In fact, given our HF problems here, I think CW might be the only way I can break through the noise. But I want to learn it. I think it sounds great. It takes some time, and it would have taken me a lot longer to become a ham if I'd had to know the code.
Yeah. So I think we've gotten a lot of people in since we've lost code as a requirement.
Oh, it's clear. Yeah.
And what they're telling me is that more and more people are using it because they don't have to go learn it.
So right.
Now it's fun.
Exactly.
Again.
Become a ham, and eventually everybody's going to want to learn code, I think. Well, not everybody. Most.
What the hams out there, whenever I did Ham Nation, and I mean, they all said, well, is Leo going to be on the show tonight? You're a busy guy.
When Ham Nation started, it was, I was on it a few times, but my goal was to let Gordo and Bob run the show and have it be their own thing. Partly because I already do 12 shows. It would have been my 13th show of the week. And it's later in the day too, you know, so it would have made my day kind of long.
Yeah.
Then I came in and we had all sorts of technical difficulties and I was realizing that my lack of attention had kind of hurt the show. So I got mad and I said, well, I'm going to be here until we get this solved. So I did a couple of months, maybe more, and it's so much fun. I really enjoy doing it, but it was taking its toll. I wasn't getting home for dinner. It was taking its toll. So once the show kind of got on a good footing, we solved the technical issues. I got the production staff here in line. I felt like, well, they can go back to doing it on their own. And I show up from time to time. I love doing it. It's a lot of fun, but it's kind of because of the scheduling and everything. It's kind of one more thing.
And the last things hams, I think, really want to know is, are they ever going to get to just talk to you
no.
on the air?
Yes, they are. Okay, so that's the real, I know, that's the real question is, now that I took the time to learn all this stuff and I got my general license how long ago now? It's last summer in July.
You got the station here, but there's some technical issues with noise and it's hard to use.
It's probably the case that if we had an HF antenna, I'd be doing more of it. But I do have a working UHF VHF. My handy talkies work. And we have a Comet antenna on the roof, which works pretty well. Yeah. With the 2820, the ICOM 2820.
And as everybody knows, that's not just local anymore because of the internet connectivity.
D-Star and relaying and all of that stuff, it's great. I mean, and it's fun. You know what the real truth is, Gary? I talk all day, every day. I'm on the radio and I'm on the internet all the time.
Yeah.
And the last thing I want to do is, Art Bell would do his show and then would get on and would do another 5 hours on the 10 meter band or whatever. But I'm just tired and I just want to go home. So as much as I've got, you know, I look at that gear and I just want to use it so badly. It's on my list, my bucket list of things. And I have a feeling that when I retire, I'll probably be spending a lot more time on the airwaves.
But have you spent very much time, I mean, just being in a ham environment?
Well, that's part of it, too. I'm still very uncomfortable getting on the air.
Because it's different than broadcasting.
It's very different. I don't have any trouble talking, obviously. But there's a culture and a code and a way of doing things, and I'm not sure I really know it, you know, fully. I've had a couple of QSOs and stuff, but I need to hang out. There's some local hams that are great, and in fact, there's one that's just a few blocks away. He's from the Redwood Empire DXers. He's a great DXer, and he said, "Come, just hang out with me, and you'll learn." And that's my plan to do that. You know?
And I think you'd be recognized by some people, but there've been a lot of celebrity hams. And
oh, I'm sure I can get away with it.
In the culture,
I'm no Joe Walsh.
Well, yeah, I mean, but in the culture, we tend to
not be too moonstruck.
No, I'm not worried about that. Although we did get quite a few pileups.
Well, because it's like when you crash a website.
Right.
You're broadcasting that you're going to be there, so yeah. Boom. And I think maybe that's given you sort of a false sense of what would happen if you just got on the plate.
I think really the issue is I talk all the time, and I don't. You know, it's funny. I'm kind of an introvert, and
a lot of broadcasters.
I go home and I just want to shut up. So, and I think most hams tend to be extroverts. They're friendly people who really like other people, want to talk to them, and I feel like I've kind of done my duty now. I want to shut up.
I'm not sure that's really true. I think I look at ham radio as the old broadcasting joke. How can you tell the extrovert at the engineer's Christmas party? He's the one looking at everybody else's shoes.
I don't know. Hams are pretty gregarious. I tell you, we're going to be at the ham party at the NAB show, and it'll be a fun party. They're out there. They're fun. What I love about hams is they're the original geeks. They really are. You know, I recognize it so well because I've grown up as a geek in a geek culture, and it's just I feel like I'm among my own immediately, and it's really really fun. I love hams. I'm a bad ham, Gary. I'm a bad.
Well, you're
ham.
A new ham.
I'm a new ham still.
And you got a lot to learn, but you're a busy guy. What I recommend.
I don't have time for hobbies. That's really my problem.
Yep.
This is my hobby.
What I recommend is that you spend some time listening.
Yes.
Because you will not learn anything by talking.
No, I will do that. In fact, you're not the first to say that. Just dial in. As soon as I get an antenna on this thing, I can spend some time. I want to do some DXing. I really want to listen. You know, when I was a kid, one of my favorite things, I had a shortwave radio. One of my favorite things to do was shortwave DXing, and it was really fun. And so I'd be very comfortable just tuning around on the band and hearing what's going on. That'd be fun for me.
Yep. Well, I want to express my appreciation for everything you've done for ham radio. You've raised the visibility with Ham Nation a lot. Everywhere.
Well, thank you for filling in on that show. I really appreciate it.
I had so much fun doing that.
Yeah.
And as I talked to you on the air a couple of weeks ago, I got in on the phone.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, how funny.
Yep. And you gave me a big plug for the podcast that I've started because I had so much fun doing.
Oh, I remember now.
Ham Nation.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah,
and,
yeah.
And there were so many things I couldn't do in the limited time I had with that. I thought, I can do my
own. Do it yourself.
Yeah.
And really, it's funny. I think sometimes people think, well, why would you want to promote competition? But I don't ever see it as competition. I think the more people who do their own shows, the better in any topic. It's not competition for us. It just makes the category richer and more interesting.
Yeah. And that's a great thing about you because a lot of people would say, why would he give you any advice and say, that's great, go ahead and do it. And here, let me plug it a little bit.
Right.
But that's the
way it's been the truth is, this is why I don't spend much time on the ham airwaves is, this is my hobby, my life. This is what I spend all my time thinking about. I love what I do, and I kind of proselytize for others to do it because it's so much fun. So podcasting and broadcasting even, for me, are really a way of life. I really love it.
Well, there are so many other things I would love to talk to you about, but you got
another show to do. Poor Dick DiMartolo, he's waiting for me. He's just talking. He's a talker. Look, he's just talking up a storm. He doesn't care. He's talking to the chat room.
So we'll wait till you retire, and then we'll look for you on 20 meters.
Yeah, well, one of the reasons that I wanted to become a ham is my dream, my goal, is to retire onto a boat, live aboard, and travel around the world on a boat. And, of course, no better place.
Ham radio's
perfect. I won't have any trouble with the antenna.
Know a lot of people who
do
that.
Nice and quiet out in the middle of the ocean. So that's a lot of the reason why I wanted to learn this is one of the many skills that I felt like I needed to have before I do this dream of sailing around the world.
Yeah, a lot of hams have done that.
Yeah.
It is fun.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Leo.
Gary.
All right.
Yay.
I only want 6 more hours.
I know. Well, stick around. I got a show to do, and then I got another show to do, but then I'll be done. I'll be done sometime this century.
Cindy's favorite show on the network is iPad.
Oh, good.
Wow. What a place. Which you haven't seen. We won't pretend you haven't seen it, and have just watched the video that we just spent through. But I was amazed at what Leo built. It's a television studio. Mm-hmm. Multiple programs, you know, hopefully you're familiar with what they do on TWiT and watch stuff besides Ham Nation.
Yeah.
I mostly listen to, because I don't have a lot of time to just sit there and go, but I'll get the audio versions and I'll listen to a lot of them. And then if they've got something that I need to see, I'll go back and watch.
Yeah, it's great listening while on a road trip.
Yep. So
These programs, too.
Yeah, probably you can. Yeah, I make the audio version generally available, although this program you're probably going to want to watch.
Well, there's a lot of video in it, yeah.
So, but the Talking Head programs are just radio programs that I put cameras on, which is the way a lot of Leo's programs are. Yeah, he'll talk about it that way, the radio programs that he has cameras pointed at. But they've clearly built a television studio. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's not a huge one, but who else has done anything like this? CNET has got the facilities of CBS mm-hmm. to do their stuff. And almost nobody else has done anything in this direction. But this is sort of the future.
Well, I look forward to seeing the video that everybody else just saw.
Okay. See the little blinking red light? We're almost out of tape.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Jeff. Thanks for coming back. It's been a while since I've had you on the show.
Thanks for having me. It's been long now.
Back again soon. You're very popular out there. People like to watch you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And let's close the program. Do you remember now how we close the program?
I remember it's something we do the same thing all the time.
We do. I say, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
And I must say, I'm Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
73, over.
And out.
Cut the headshots and go with the video.